Mr. Anderson?
Well, I also would thank you, Mr. Mayor and Vice Mayor Connolly and members of council. Point out this is oddly enough the first time I've had to do a formal presentation to you, so bear with me on that. I am Greg Anderson. I'm chair of the Falls Church City School Board. We do have several other members here tonight. Our vice chair, Shauna Russell, Laura Downs, Sue Dimmick, and Lawrence Webb are here, and others were here but have had to leave, so I thank you guys for coming out tonight. Tonight, I do have the honor of presenting to you the school board's advertised budget for the fiscal year 2021, and it's a relatively brief presentation, and then we'll be happy to do questions from there. I always like to start a presentation where I'm representing a group of people by thanking at least the senior folks of that group of people, and so I would like to take a moment to say thank you to Dr. Noonan and his team, especially our chief operations officer, Kristen Michael, and our Director of Budget and Finance, Michelle Kopic, who are here, and point out that we have a significant number of the senior staff for the schools here, and thank you very much for coming. Fiscally prudent budget that meets our school's needs while remaining within the council guidance, and meeting the spirit of our revenue sharing framework that we've had. Also want to thank my colleagues on the board who engaged quite a bit and lots of questions through thorough commentary about the budget development, and then all of the staff and parents and community members and all the others who have given us input along the way. It's been a long and thorough process. So our fundamental mission is to provide to each of our students the highest quality public education we can with the resources available to us. And my mission tonight is to describe to you how our budget request would support that. Starting with our vision statement, which is summarized here on the screen, and I won't take the time to read it, you all can do that. But I will point out that below that, there are some division level goals that the board has approved for the year, and they summarize a lot of what you will see coming up in the presentation. IB for all, so the International Baccalaureate framework underlies all of the instructional practices for our schools. And when we say IB for all, we really mean all, and we'll talk a little bit about what that means. Another goal for the division is caring community and culture, and this is really focusing on the social and emotional needs of our students, our staff, our community at large, and then closing gaps. We're committed to equity and inclusion to meet their own particular needs for their best success. And I want to point out that for some groups, that means providing more deliberately than to groups that otherwise don't need that level of support. This is all tied to our divisional triennial plan, which underlies all of that work. And as a highlight, I just want to point out we have made, the board has decided we want to make diversity, equity, and inclusion a focus for our work over the coming year, and we're going to be having more conversation about that at a work session coming up on March 17th. So for the public and anybody else who'd like to come and hear more, that would be an opportunity. So with that background, I just want to share some successes we've had along the way in meeting that vision and meeting those goals. We have not a lot of time. We could spend a long time up here talking about this, so I'm just going to pick some selected highlights. So first, I want to present some data that's come out of comparisons with FCCPS and the state on college and career readiness. The figure here, the chart on the left side, shows the distribution of the types of diplomas and certificates that have earned by students in the 2019 school year in the state at the top and our schools at the bottom. And the main thing I want to point out is that last year for our schools, 72% of the students that graduated in our schools graduated with an advanced diploma, as opposed to just over 50% statewide. 100%. And that is compared to just under in the state. There's about 5.6% of a dropout rate statewide. So we know all of our students. We know they all graduated. How did we do on another measure of success? And I only want to say this is just one measure, because standardized testing is one measure but not the only one for this. To point out the standards of learning pass rates for 2018-2019, the state numbers there for the various five various categories that are in that, and then our school success rate, pass rate there. And I'd like to point out for the first time in the last 4 years, all of our pass rates for all of the SOL assessments, 90% plus. So that's a real success. One piece of improvement in that number, it's in there, is the math. Math curriculum improvement for SOL has been particularly noteworthy. A lot of work from our math coordinator, Jen Fessenden, who's made a lot of work into that. But there is also room for improvement, particularly in language arts, and that's a bit of foreshadowing to come up. So I said earlier, IB for all, it really does mean all. Just like to point out for us, the IB framework underlies instruction throughout the schools. It starts with the primary years program, the PYP, and all the way up through fifth grade, and then moves. Every one of our students in elementary and middle school goes through that instructional framework, through that program. So that's that 100% there on the left. Once you get to your junior year, you have a choice you can make. You can either pursue a full IB diploma, or you can continue in another track that leads to an advanced diploma or a standard diploma and take IB courses that you choose. Last year, 86% of our juniors and 87% of our seniors enrolled in at least one IB course, and we also had 47 students go all the way through and earn a full IB diploma last year. That's quite a rigorous two-year curriculum to get that IB diploma. Starting with having to get up pretty early in the morning to talk about the theory of knowledge in a really wonderful course, but that's quite an accomplishment for our students to achieve that level. I'd like to point out Wednesday night there is an opportunity if you want to see some of this year's middle years program results. The students are going to present their personal project showcase at George Mason from 7 to 8 o'clock. There's also International Night that precedes that from 5:30 to 7, so come and have some good food and see what our students have been up to. And then a little bit of highlights on some other things, and again, I like pictures, so here are my pictures. We have had quite a range of J. and Henderson students who went to the MathCon National Championship in Chicago. Alex, a student up there in the red shirt in the top, won the gold medal, so that was pretty cool. Every year, our seniors wrap up their educational experience with externships, and last year, a couple of our seniors got to go to work at Save the Children and happened to run into Jennifer Garner while they were there, so that was kind of cool. Our give day, our students, the pun here is our students give back. Our give day ambassadors at Henderson, the Give Day Club raised over $10,000 this year to pack 33,000 meals to go to Madagascar for people who need help. And our Give Day ambassadors at TJ spent Martin Luther King Day assembling power packs of food for local families right here in Falls Church, household items for the Home Stretch program, and also working on the lovely mosaic that's out there in the entry to City Hall. And then in the lower right, most recently, our girls basketball team at the high school were Region 3B champions this year and competed in the state championship. Very proud of them for getting to that point. And then one that's not shown, but I'll just take a moment of privilege to say that the George Mason Wind Ensemble competed at the District 10 Band Assessment last Friday night and received unanimous superior ratings, playing the top level of music that one can play on for, but we don't really have an infinite amount of time, so we won't do that. Another area of success, and this one I really want to point out, with continued partnership from you, from our community, and the support of a lot of folks involved, construction on the new George Mason High School continues on schedule and on budget. The figure on the left shows what it's going to look like when it's completed, and the figure on the right shows basically what it looked like just a few days ago. There are a variety of cameras. If folks want to watch the construction, you can do that live on the web. And this is one of the new cameras that's been put up to show you what is effectively the front of the building to come. On February 22nd, several of the people here in the room had the opportunity to sign the last steel beam for the mainframe of the building before it was lifted into place with a traditional topping out ceremony, complete with the tree and the flag. For those who are interested in the tradition of topping out ceremonies, that dates back to the idea of thanking the forest for giving us the wood that we need to build our buildings. We remain on track for a December 2020 move-in and the start of new classes at the new high school in January of 2021. And again, we thank you for your partnership and support in being able to carry that out. Another shared success that we've had with the general government is what we'll call here prudent fiscal management, based on what's called the local composite index, determine how much money school divisions in Virginia receive from the Commonwealth versus from local sources. Falls Church has the highest local composite index possible of 0.8, which means that we depend on local sources for the vast bulk of our funding. Because of that, we know that we also have a serious responsibility, and we take it very seriously, to ensure that we're meeting our school needs, but also being prudent stewards of the taxpayer money, and asking for what we need, but not asking for too much. Two figures here to demonstrate how we've been able to do that over the last decade. On the left, in the blue, is the growth in student enrollment from 2011 to last year, and that's an increase of 24%. On the same percent scale, so that ranges are actually comparable, in orange is shown the inflation-adjusted per pupil cost over the same period of time. 24% increase in students, the per pupil cost is essentially flat. So as Mr. Shields alluded to, we are doing more with the same and paying a lot of attention to this. If you prefer to think in nominal dollars and not in inflation adjusted dollars, on the right is a figure that's showing a comparison for our per pupil spending growth over the last decade compared to the other jurisdictions. Just wish to point out that we are the fourth lowest in that region. So we've been able to carry out this success with a lot of careful attention and a lot of helpful partnership and support on behalf of the council. So thank you. So moving on to the 2020 budget, I would just like to point out everything that I'm about to show you is available on the web at fccps.org/budget. It all comes together into a book that's 200 or 300 pages getting at this point. And it represents a lot of work, just as for Mr. Shields and Ms. Bawa and the city government and the city staff. This is a long development process that started for us back in the summer of 2019. School board received information beginning in the fall about enrollment, more details about what the budget request was probably going to be looking like. And then in early December, we met together for our joint discussion of the budget and received your guidance as to the budget, as to the budget increase that council wanted us to consider. On January 14th, Dr. Noonan presented his proposed budget to the school board, and since then we've had a series of meetings and work sessions to discuss this in a great deal of detail. And on February 18th, we voted to adopt the budget that I will present to you tonight. Starting with this, and the general categories of expenditure in the budget request that we have for you. 81% of the requested revenues in our budget come from local sources. As I mentioned, the LCI sets that as a fairly high number. We do have some good news out of the Commonwealth. The amount of money that we expect to get from the state has gone up fairly significantly this year and now makes almost 15% of the budget revenues that are coming in. The remaining 3.6% is made up of federal sources and fees, other sorts of things. And in the end, the total budget request is the total budget amount that is necessary to support is $54,594,282. Now, the city transfer that's listed there is based on prior to knowing what the actual amount of the funding that was going to be available based on the revenue sharing framework. So that's a little bit lower than what Mr. Shields just presented you, but the difference is because we have had a higher revenue that came in than we expected to have. So on the right side, you see our basically where the money would go. And education is driven by people. That's represented here. The biggest part of our budget request, over 86%, is salaries and benefits for our staff. The remaining just under 14% goes to our total budget request is up total budget is up 4.4% relative to last year, and the total city transfer is up in this request, 3.1 was the original guidance number, but 3.3 being what's available at this point, as Mr. Shields pointed out. And the board has set basically two main areas of priority. that I want to highlight for you. Priority one is employee compensation. Our people make the successes possible that I showed you earlier, and investing in our team is the board's top priority. There's two categories of employee compensation that I want to highlight in here. The items in blue are in some sense mandatory. They're mandated by the Commonwealth, or they're reflecting increases in our insurers. In particular, there are changes to the actuarial assumptions that are used for the Virginia retirement system, and that drives some of those changes. So these are the sorts of mandatory increases that we've got to deal with. Below that in the green is really the board saying these are the things that we think are important. And this boils down to a step increase for eligible employees, which averages out to an increase of about 2.7%. And that just under $1 million for that. There's also built into our budget request basically takes our salary scale and moves it up as a whole in order to remain competitive with the local jurisdictions around us. This is, in total, a structure that is similar to the sorts of changes that are being proposed in other local school divisions. The details for all of those, in some cases, are fairly complex, but they're in large part comparable to what's shown here. Priority number two is a set of investments for our future that are aligned with our divisional goals. These boil down into this table that's described here, but that represents the end process of a very long collaborative process through the division to identify what would be priority investments, look at them on a division-wide level, and then bring forward the top choices here. At the top, under the category, and in here you see what the item is, how it is aligned with our primary goals, and what the amount would be in 21. At the top is an additional person to help coordinate our middle years program at the high school and middle school. It is a big enough job that it needs two people to do, and we've learned that over the past few years. So in order to be able to provide the sort of IB support that we want to be able to provide, that's in here. I said earlier that we had had good success with emphasis and that's what this next entrance, next line here represents. A new person, a new job as language arts coordinator for the division that will help us close the gaps for those students who need extra support to be able to achieve the highest that they can in the language arts. We also have a focus this year on caring community and culture, and one element of that is an additional social worker to help support the needs of our students emotionally and their well-being as a whole. There are some adjustments that we're proposing to make to contract to certain individuals, some individuals who are on 11-month contract that really should be on a 12-month contract, and some other adjustments that add up there. And then at our Jesse Thackeray preschool, there is a need to increase our office support and our clinic support so that we can free up our director at there to be able to do higher level support for the students and for the school and for the staff that needs to get done. We love having folks care at all levels, but this frees up that caring to be distributed in a way that works more effectively. And then finally, we are opening a new high school, and that new high school comes with 100,000 extra square feet to maintain, and part of that is custodial support here to make sure that that new school is up and going. Other investments came through that process, and they're not on this list because they are on a list that shows up in another slide, and I'll talk about those in a minute. So those are our priority investments. That's where we intend to be spending money. But where is the additional funding coming from? So as I said earlier, we have some good news from the Commonwealth. We expect to see a significant increase in state funding, largely due to a rebaselining exercise that they have done to fund at a higher level the standards of quality for the state of Virginia. This is money that we can use because we already have quality that exceeds the requirements, so we can use this elsewhere. A little bit less money from federal sources, but it's basically flat. It's a fairly small difference. And then we have gone through and identified savings within the budget from reductions and from realignments, particularly salary lapse, as people who are paid at a high level and have retired or otherwise left the division are replaced with people perhaps with less experience. But there's a little bit of savings there. And then there's some other savings largely related to retirement benefits and benefits for our employees. That leaves down here our city transfer request, and I'll come back to that, as I said before. I would like to point out that the savings from reductions and realignments may not be here as you find these, but we keep scrubbing and keep scrubbing and we keep finding, and so we are going to keep that up, but it may not be the same next year. I said that there are unfunded needs, and during the budget process, the staff identified a variety of additional needs that we were unable to include in the advertised budget. And we do maintain this list as a record of those unmet needs, partially so that if additional funding comes forward, the board can reprioritize this list, which right here is just an alphabetical order, so not order of priority. And also because this allows us to remember what we need when we come to next year. Last year's list of unfunded needs have all been included in this year's budget, and that's having this information is very helpful for that process. So to wrap it all up in one slide, this is intended to summarize everything that I've talked to you about. The top three lines are our two big priorities and the total increase in expenditures across the division, an increase just over $2.5 million. The next chunk is the change that we are expecting in revenues, state revenue increase, a slight decrease in the federal revenue, some savings that we have identified, so I'm treating that as revenue in this figure, it's really savings. And so that ends up with us making a request to of a city transfer of $1.34 million, and that's at 3.1%. It's actually a little bit more with the 3.3% that's available, but that number was just known. So that basically brings that to a close, except for one thing. I opened with thanks. I want to close with thanks, and I want to thank again our staff and my colleagues in our community. But I also want to thank you for your partnership over the years and your support of our schools and your engagement. We've had a lot of joint successes, and particularly in the last few years since I've been on the board, I just thought about this, and we've had the high school project and the West End Little City Commons. We've had our spirit of our revenue sharing framework, even though it's just a framework, and the recent budget cycles, as Mr. Shields alluded to, for the last couple of years. We've been within guidance, and that's made a much smoother process. So I'm looking forward to answering any questions that you might have, and thank you.
All right, well, thank you. I'll start with thank you as well. You guys have done some really, really great things, senior accomplishments, and with kids. Many of us have kids in the school system. I think we're all well aware of the great work you all are doing, and I think working together we can accomplish some great things, and we're in the midst of that right now, so we greatly appreciate it. I don't know how we want to do this. We can either start with Mr. Shields and work our way back, or start with Mr. Anderson and work back. We do have, the Vice Mayor and I have any thoughts on how you want to proceed as far as questions go? All right, then I'm going to go ahead. We're going to start with Mr. Shields, and maybe if we can't just, and we'll start also with some disclosures. Vice Mayor Conley, did you want to go ahead and read one?
I make the following statement before City Council's receipt and consideration of the manager's report budget items and before consideration of TO 20-03, a FY 2020 budget amendment. I am an employee of the Falls Church City School Board, and therefore I'm a member of a group of three or more persons that may be affected by the FY 2020 budget. I can participate in this matter fairly objectively and in the public interest.
And I similarly want to make a statement. I make the following statement before City Council's receipt of the manager's report on budget items and before consideration of TO 20-03, an amendment to the FY 2020 budget. Do I have the wrong disclosure here, City Manager? This isn't an amendment, is it, to the 2020 budget?
The next one. It's the manager's in our next
statement. I know, so don't we have one for this as well?
This is forever.
Okay, I'm sorry. An amendment to the FY 2020 budget. My wife's an employee of the Falls Church City School Board, and therefore I'm a member of a group of three or more persons that may be affected by the FY 2020 budget. I can participate in the matter fairly objectively in the public interest. All right, well, let's go ahead with questions from including the public, that this is the start of a process. There's plenty more plenty more meetings, plenty more discussion, plenty more opportunities for public comments. So tonight is just the start of a long process, and so I think we need to keep that in mind as we discuss our discussion begins tonight. So with that, Mr. Duncan?
Can I just start with a couple of quick things for Greg?
Of course.
First, I'm shocked that this is the first full-blown presentation you've ever made to council, because I feel like, you know, we've often said up here that you feel like the eighth city council member because you've attended. I haven't missed a meeting. Hardly any of us miss meetings, but the man is at every meeting. And seriously, that, you know, A, is a huge commitment because we know you've got plenty of other meetings. But two, it's fostered you and your colleagues have fostered a very productive working relationship with the current council. And as somebody who came in 8 years ago believing that, you know, in order for the community and the schools to prosper, we needed to grow the local economy so as to provide the resources for the deep well of want that we all have for excellence in every endeavor, it's encouraging to see after all these years that that is the way things have turned out, and that when times are that we're trying to fit our budgets into the economic growth that we've been able to accomplish, and we appreciate you all doing that. We also understand that the general buoyancy of the regional economy that Mr. Shields referred to is not forever, and so it's always good to live close to the bone, because you never know when one of those years is going to turn up when we all have to, you know, midway through make some adjustments. The only specific question I had was, I know down in Richmond there had been some talk about, and by the way, it's very encouraging to hear that we're getting more, even though it's not a huge amount, it's a significant uptick, I think. I mean, I recall that our budget from Richmond was, I don't know, down below 10% at some point, I think, their contribution to our budget. Mr. Snyder has spoken a lot about that over the years, and it's nice to see that number going up, too. The minimum wage work that they've done down there in the current General Assembly, I'm just wondering how many employees do we have, and this is true of the city, too, who are earning, you know, the equivalent of hourly minimum wage, and do we as a city or in the school system have a plan for accelerating that number, hopefully at least as fast as Richmond contemplates, maybe a little faster? Is that a knowable fact?
It is. It is not known to me at the moment, however. So
I didn't mean to throw a stumper at you, but it was on my mind when I read about the General Assembly's work.
It's a great question, and one we're sort of proud to be able to answer. The first step in the new minimum wage is to go up to $9.50 an hour. And currently we don't have any employees that are below that number. So we'll at least meet the first threshold, and we'll begin to plan for the next round of advancement on the minimum wage scale, which I think is $12 after that.
Okay, great. Well, I'd encourage that. I mean, there was some talk, you know, that Richmond might have gone a little faster in their plans to increase the minimum wage because as we all know, you know, even at an increased rate, it's not enough to support a family with less than two or three jobs probably, but I would love to see Falls Church be a leader in that area if we can, and set a standard that other school systems would look up to. Oh, and the only other question I had for you, I think I asked you this once, and this may also not be knowable, is there another jurisdiction in the globe which aspires to be a, you know, pre-K through 12 IB program in a jurisdiction of our small size?
That aspires to be a pre-K-12 school district or the best?
We aspire and have achieved excellence. Is there any other jurisdiction smaller than us that has, you know, the same kind of aspirations?
There are in the country that are our size that have aspirational goals as well. I don't know that they read exactly like ours, but we do in some ways benchmark against those districts and feel like we are doing a really great job in comparison. So we are certainly giving, I think, IB school divisions around the country something to shoot to. And to that point, just as a very quick aside, last Monday I had an opportunity to sit on a panel at Bronx Community College with a variety of IB school divisions from around the country. And we were invited there for a reason by the director of IB, and it was because of our great work here in the city of Falls Church.
That's great. Well, the only reason I ask that, you know, there's a lot of measurements that you see in magazines and online, and everybody's got a,
sure,
you know, and I know you all have, it's a full-time job keeping up with all of them and how they do their measurings, but I just think it's important for the people in the community to understand that we, you know, we have very high standards that we seek to achieve for a jurisdiction, although affluent, which is small. I mean, we are a small jurisdiction, and it's a commendable endeavor that you all are engaged in, and we try to match it on the city side. So thank you for that answer. I appreciate it.
Absolutely.
All right. Other comments, questions? Mr. Lichtenhaus.
Are we still going first? All right.
You want, whatever. All right,
I'll start with the schools because it's shorter. I've had the good fortune of coming in on, I think, at least a couple easy budgets over the last couple of years, thanks to you guys and the hard work from staff and the city. My favorite part about this part of the year, and I think that it's rare that you can say that, are the budget buddies that you guys assigned to us from the school board. I've had the good fortune of spending time over coffee with Greg and Shauna, and I don't know if it's a symptom of this budget year being easy, but my current budget buddy, Laura Downs, promised me a beer about 2 months ago, and I have yet to see that materialize, so I just wanted to put that on public record, yes. The favorite part of budget season for me has just been yanked from me. So, but in all seriousness, I am serious about that, actually. I expect that. But thank you, guys. Greg, thanks for the presentation. Just a couple quick questions. How many schools in Virginia offer a K through 12 IB program? Do you know? It doesn't have to be exact. I mean, I'm just trying to get an idea. Just this one.
That's right. There are eight two. Right.
Okay. Great. I had a conversation with a friend of mine whose daughter goes to Marshall, and man, I've got my three daughters. One, I'm just going into middle school. Things have really changed. So getting an understanding of how folks are getting up to like close to a 5.0 GPA with all of the diplomas that they're getting, it's totally bananas to me. But what I did get out of the conversation that he had, I've always valued the IB program that we have through this K through 12, is just the value of that to schools and to others that look at Falls Church having offered that. And it's impressive, and I think I've always thought it was impressive, but I don't think it really resonated with me until I started to talk to peers who have kids that are graduating from high school and what they're doing to kind of kick and scratch to at least get to some, you know, some semblance of kind of an IB education. The 47 students that we had graduate in 2019 with the IB diploma, just generally speaking, I recognize the value of that. How do we get that from 47 up to, you know, a vast majority of the students? I know it's incredibly rigorous. I'm aware of that, but is there anything else that we can do to help increase that other than general resources? Yeah.
First of all, thank you very much for recognizing the value of the IB program. I do think it is an extraordinarily rigorous program, and when you put it all together, pieces that you have to have in combination with a certain set of scores to be able to get the diploma that are adjudicated externally is not an insignificant task. I also would say it's not for everybody, and I would posit to say that we should not make more IB diplomas the goal, but rather more access to the IB program the goal. And so in my previous budget presentations, you know, some of you might be familiar with Piaget's work. Piaget was a big child psychologist back in the day, and his sample size was two. It was his kids. And so I often use my own kids as my sample. So my daughter achieved the IB diploma, was a hardworking, solid student, worked really day in and day out. My son, also a solid student when he puts his mind to it, but tends to dabble in school a little bit sometimes, and he's not going to be an IB diploma candidate, but he is taking four IB courses. So he's had the exposure to the rigor of the IB program, but is taking courses that he's really excited about. So he's taking the History of the Americas course, he's taking the film study course, he's taking a computer science course, he's taking those things that he's really interested in. So the main goal for me as the superintendent in the IB district is to expose kids to point, and they've had the PYP program and the MYP program, they are really prepared for that rigor in that 11th and 12th grade, but maybe not all as motivated to take that full course load necessary to get the IB diploma. So all that to say, we did see an increase from last year, from the year before to last year. But I would say that a 25% rate of an IB diploma is pretty strong across
the
board.
That's great. Okay. Thanks for that explanation. Just a couple quick questions. The social worker that you guys are bringing on, is that floating for all of the school system? Is that how that works? I just didn't see that assigned to a particular school.
It's currently unassigned. It would be considered a division-wide social work position. We have two part-time social workers. So one of the things that may happen is both of those part-time people could go full-time. We have a real need in this system for a social worker that speaks Spanish. And so we may be looking to add another social worker that also speaks Spanish and keep two part-time positions. That is something that we'll continue to look at. But we need the position to either make two full-time or have one new person full-time.
Okay. And then just a question about competitiveness amongst other jurisdictions in terms of staffing and, you know, attracting, retaining the best and brightest teachers that we can. The but I also know that they are absolutely just cash rich because of a lot of the data center revenue that's thrown off. Comparing ourselves to some of the other jurisdictions that have increased that spending, I assume a lot of that goes to, does that a lot, I shouldn't assume that, but does a lot of that go to paying for staff? Is it COLA increases? Is it step increases?
It's a little bit of, it's a little bit of COLA, it's a little bit of step, and then there has been some readjustment in the broad salary structure in Loudoun and in Fairfax to raise their overall scale rather significantly, so they would infuse into that scale a certain amount of money. So with respect to comparative salaries, the Virginia Education Association, or VEA, did a salary study last year and sent us the data. And one of the things that the data showed was regardless of where you were on the scale, whether you're first year, bachelor's, mid-career, master's, end of career with a doctorate, the City of Falls Church was within the top five of all the school divisions across the Commonwealth with respect to salary. There are some places that we lag down in five, and there have been some modifications done in Loudoun County, for example, that have changed the game a little bit. They now have a starting teacher salary that's but we have the city, and there are some other benefits that are sort of unspoken about that I think we try to do a good job when we recruit. Amy Hall, who's our HR director, was here earlier, and she goes out on recruiting trips with some of our staff and talk about things like our student-teacher ratio is 22 to 1 or 24 to 1. We know our families. We get FaceTime with everybody in the division, regardless of who it is. You get to know your superintendent, for better or for worse. You know, you get to see me in the school. So there are some other intangible benefits that I think the City of Falls Church brings. And to that end, just in the last month, we did our annual survey of staff to find out your intention for next year. And for the first time in the history of Falls Church, we don't have one special education teacher that's given us any indication that they're leaving. Which, it, by the way, is one of the hardest positions to fill across the Commonwealth. So knowing that at this point in time, we're going to have zero turnover in special ed and minimal turnover in the other positions, we feel like what we're doing is the right mix of STEP and COLA and sort of that Falls Church City, oh my gosh, I can't believe I said that, Falls Church City charm that keeps people here.
Thank you for that. Yeah, I would just say that that or made it a priority, at least in terms of you know, staying competitive from a salary perspective. Frankly, from staffing both the city and the schools, that's probably my biggest concern over the next 10-15 years is the competitiveness with other jurisdictions and remaining competitive with pay scale and benefits. So thank you. That's all the questions I have.
I would just build a little bit on that, also to point out that this has actually been after the culmination of a few years of effort from prior boards to get the salary scale for us and benchmarking ourselves against Arlington and Fairfax County to try to bring ourselves more into a more competitive position, which we've succeeded on, you know, within those constraints that we talked about. So,
all right, who's next? Ms. Hardy.
Great.
Thank you. Thank you very much for great budget presentations all around. I'll start with schools since you're already there, Greg. Turning actually towards the CIP, I don't need the answer now, but I think budget is always as good a time as any to talk about capital planning. So while we have clearly a big CIP underway, I don't think it's ever early enough to start planning for the next 10 years out. And when I looked at it, it looks like we have TJ in FY 2026 for $1 million. Do we have anything else on the horizon besides TJ needing some money 5 years from now?
Not that I'm aware of, but I could bring up my book if you really want me to try to answer that right now.
Don't need to answer now. And then a more general question, which I think would be helpful exercise for us as we think about kind of what the need we have at each of our schools in terms of capacity. Hopefully a lot of years at the new Mason that'll open next year. But I'd love to make sure that we are staying on top of that, because I think what I found myself in 4 years ago was realizing, gosh, we had so much capital needs everywhere. And I want to make sure we are more thoughtful now that we have, you know, the big stuff hopefully underway and about to open in the next year, that we're actually looking ahead at the next 10 years and are thoughtfully planning out and spacing out where the growth needs to happen at each of our, you know, buildings, whether it's schools or general government. So I think it's a good discussion, just come budget time. Don't need the answer now.
Okay, sure. Well, I will answer briefly just to say we receive projections for enrollment from Weldon Cooper on an ongoing basis every year. They don't take into account some of the development that's happening locally here, but we are able to do that. And we are paying attention to capacity issues to make sure that we have that space. Right now, we do, and we're just keeping focused on that for coming years. So
great. Thank you. And then turning to the general government, look at my questions there. So Wyatt, as we're going to ask every year, and I think as Ross started alluding to, I'd love for us to know what our numbers look like compared to the region, both in terms of our AV growth as well as planned salary increases, et cetera.
We can certainly get that information to you. The presentation usually has the comparison of all the tax rates for tonight, but we'll get that out to the council as well. But I think that chart looks pretty similar to the way it has in the past.
Great. And then on, I think it's probably this point, 6 or 9 months ago, we were talking about kind of employee morale and benchmarking salary and benefits. Do we have any of that input into kind of this year's budget? Because I do want to make sure that's top of mind for us as we're caring for people, that not only we're increasing salaries and giving people raises, but our benefits are also on par with what we think they need to be.
We are still getting the compensation figures from our surrounding jurisdictions, and we will do that comparison. We went off of the best information that we had, and what we're doing on compensation, I believe, is comparable to what are to the best information I have right now. Our surrounding jurisdictions haven't finished up their budgets, and in fact, some of the smaller ones haven't presented yet. But based on our information, it is competitive. We are doing an employee survey this year, and I think that gives us good data with what specifically is on employees' minds. And when we do that survey, we also do it with a commitment that we listen to it, we learn from it, and we follow up on those things that we can follow up on.
Great. And being small, I know that often on salary, we may not be as competitive, but I want to make sure we look at total compensation and benefits. So one that stood out to me in this is really thought was pretty inadequate. So I would love for us to actually invest in those places, because I think those matter to employee morale at the end of the day too. Second kind of detailed comment, and then I just have a general one. I just need more time to digest the rest of the budget presentation. So I don't think anyone's forgotten that majority of the comments we've gotten so far in the past 3 months have been on traffic calming. And so I'm glad to see that number one, we have a lot of money set aside both from grants as well as in our budget. I want to make sure we also have people to get them done. So I know that within there, it looked like we had one field worker assigned. Is that going to be on traffic calming or all sorts of projects?
It will be on multiple projects, not just traffic calming. But what it really will allow, when projects are under construction, they're very intense in terms of their management demands. And so if you have an engineer that's trying to get something through design but also managing something that's in construction, then that's how oftentimes a project that's in design gets delayed, because when it's in construction, it just requires their full attention. So having that field engineer will help relieve that and help keep our projects on schedule.
Okay. I'd ask for us to think about whether we actually need more staff to get all of the traffic calming projects done. I know we only have one person right now, and given the desire for all of us, I think, to kind of clear the queue, if we need to increase it just for the year to those things addressed, you know, I think I personally would be a little willing to support that. On sidewalks, and I think I already prefaced this concern with you, I am not comfortable sharing the sidewalk money with streetlights. So as much as I would love to make sure we do LED streetlights, for me, the priority is not an either or, and I think it should be an and. So I would love to make sure we can take care of sidewalks and do the LED light refresh at the same time. So if we can get creative and find money in the budget to do both, I think that's really important. So finally, my last comment is just a general one. So I think this is the first budget that's really comprehensive. I really appreciate that the budget is covering lots of bases. In terms of presentation, I appreciate how you've identified areas against each of those vision and value areas we've identified. So clearly, we're trying to do a lot. And I think we all are grateful for that 4% growth in AV that's enabling all this to happen. However, I don't think it's lost on any of us that this means a $322 tax increase for the average median homeowner, a TBD stormwater fee that's probably going to go up $30 or maybe $300 over the next 6 years or so. And so, especially in light of today's stock market news and everyone else's 401k reports, I'm sure, I want to make sure that we are very judicious in this budget, not only in good times as we are right now in, but that every increase we have in here is going to be sustainable for the future, and that when the bad times come, as inevitably will happen, I want to make sure that we can live within this budget or potentially less if we need to, if we don't see 4% property growth over the year.
All right, who's next? Mr. Snyder?
This is a question for both the school board and the city. Let's take a worst case where we have a fairly immediate shock, a reduction in business tax revenue, the kind of thing that we saw during the financial crisis, sudden, deep. What reserves does the city have to carry us through that sort of period, and the schools as well? What reserve are the schools carrying currently and proposed for next year? Wyatt?
Well, the City Council is currently at or slightly above its target for unassigned fund balance, and we also have the capital reserves that are part of the plan of finance for the high school as well as the library and City Hall, as those gets financed, or those have been financed. So our capital reserves currently have a balance of just about $16 million, and so that is kind of our main contingency planning. If projects get delayed, revenues get delayed, we'll still be able to meet our debt service obligations. One feature of budgeting in the city, we have now tied our fiscal year to our tax year, so our biggest area of revenue vulnerability on real estate taxes is something that if we would have a year to adjust our budgets, and we'd be having this conversation next year about how to deal with that revenue shortfall. With respect to our business taxes, it is something we just have to watch on a monthly basis, watching our sales taxes, meals taxes in particular. And we look at those on a monthly basis, and if we see them turning off of our projections, we get the word out quickly, and we start making adjustments immediately.
And for the schools, as is common in school divisions in the Commonwealth, we do have a reserve account. It's right now approximately on the order of $1 million, $1.5 million in reserves. And we receive on a monthly basis ongoing reports on the status of the budget. And if we were to get early warning of there being a shock like you're describing, we would know about it in those monthly reports, and we'd be having a discussion about reprioritization at that point. But we do have a reserve that we carry forward as part of a prudent budgeting.
Thank you.
All right, other comments? Mr. Z?
I just want to make sure that we have adequate funding in the budget going forward. Segment, in particular the police. I know we've had some concerns and difficulties in that area the past year.
If I could just make a comment about that. The chief came to the City Council and to me about 4 years ago saying we needed 4 additional police officers. And at that time, we had a strategy of overhire to try to help meet needs. Last year, for the first year, we added 1 police officer. We're adding another police officer this year. And that is because of the fact that our calls of service are increasing. They've increased dramatically in recent years. And so our police officers are running from call to call to call. And so by adding positions, we're trying to help with that workload and also trying to get back to a position where we used to have more dedicated time for traffic enforcement. But when you're running from call to call, it is hard to do some of that work that I think the community was accustomed to seeing in the area of traffic enforcement. I think that next year's budget will likely have an additional request for an additional police officer years ago of needing to step up to four additional. We're doing that in a measured way, obviously probably more measured than the chief would like, but that is the approach that's built into this budget.
Well, thank you. And I also asked that question in the context of demands from council, and I do consider them to be demands that we deploy our public safety forces to various crossings for the school stops in the morning and stop speeding on various streets in the evening. And I don't know that we have enough police officers to cover all that and to do their normal duties as well. And it's a last thing we wanted to be in a position where we're man short. So I urge you to think very carefully about where we need to go in the future. Thank you.
Any other, Mr. Duncan or Vice Mayor Connolly?
I wanted to ask city questions, is that okay. All right?
Yeah.
Well,
go ahead.
Okay.
I'll go real quick. I just didn't want to talk until everybody else had talked. The Fellows property, I know this is in the book, but we just got the book. Could you just give us a real high level of the that for?
So the that funding is to do community planning for the future of that park, and hopefully we will not use that money entirely for planning, but anything that's not spent on engineering and design will go into implementation. But we do have a larger funding amount when we do get into implementation in the out years of the CIP. We do have a sketch design that was used as part of the comprehensive plan, assigning that property for park use with a school symbol on it as well, indicating that it can mm-hmm. be used for school uses in the future. I don't think that's imminent, but obviously it's adjacent to TJ Elementary School, and so we did buy it with that sort of long-range thought in the future as well. So the basic plan that we have for the Fellows, though, is to keep it natural, to have it be a green amenity, but to be a place where children can play, where there's an opportunity. I think urban agriculture has been envisioned for this site as well. We have to work that out with the trees. The trees might have something to say about that as well. You know, those are some of the ideas that we've had about that particular parcel.
Okay. I just... It's the first action item that I was expecting on Fellows to see that we're planning down the road, which is commendable, of course.
And that
just
is imminent.
You know,
we have a contract in place for the demolition of the house that is there. The well has been capped. The well is safe. But there was some minor asbestos abatement, and that is what's delaying the actual demolition. Once that's complete, the house will be demolished.
Okay. Second question, kind of specific. You'd mentioned the paving is an area that's always a challenge for us. Also, the painting. I think you've spoken to that as an area that seems that the paint fades faster in Falls Church than almost any place that I'm familiar with. And getting paint down on the road, whether it's speed humps or parking, is a challenge for us. Is the budget that you're contemplating, got a provision for painting things up, as Letty would say, you know, clearing the queue on the paint needs that we have across the city?
Well, we really have increased our ped crossings throughout the city. I think we have 24 more ped crossings today than we did like 3 years ago.
Mm-hmm.
Those are surprisingly expensive when you put the thermoplastic down. And so we do like to try to have fresh pavement down before we make the investment in a ped crossing that's that ought to last a good 7 to 10 years. If you do put it down, break up really quickly. And if you just put paint, not thermoplastic, it fades even faster. So our plan for bike lanes and for sharrows and things like that usually is to come in right behind a fresh paving to implement what is in the adopted plans for bike facilities and street markings. And so it's a little bit of a slower rollout than I think people would like, but we try to follow the fresh pavement. So with additional pavement, we'll get more of those markings and those bike amenities out there.
Okay. Just two broader thoughts. One, seems to me that the based on the years that I've been here, the two biggest stories out of the budget, and there's a lot of great stuff in the budget, both sides. It's very encouraging to hear that all the schools' unmet needs from the last budget cycle, as I understood the presentation, have been able to be accommodated in the current budget. I mean, that's great news. That really is a testimony to how well the economy and our commitment has held up to be within a year of, you know, if I told you today that your unmet needs in this year's budget were not going to be met in the next 12 months, but that would be responded to in, you know, the year after that, that's pretty good. At any rate, that's a very good story out of the budget. The other two things are the more than $1 million on neighborhood traffic calming is, you know, fantastic. Ms. Hardy expresses about capital projects, as I've said before, as to whether, you know, we can really get all that done in the next 12 months, or is a spacing out of that work, not that it doesn't need to be done, but just, you know, can it get done? But, you know, if that's what we're committing to in this budget, I'm 100% for it. So that's very good. The second thing, and this returns back to where we started, I just wanted to come back to the affordable housing number, which is a very big deal. You know, which has, you know, come about because of assiduous efforts to cultivate a very productive relationship with Senator Saslaw and our other friends in Richmond, an effort that has been led by the mayor and the vice mayor. All seven of us went down to Richmond on Municipal League Day to speak to the majority leader. He was very accommodating. He made a lot of other very important lobbyists wait out in the hallway while he talked with Falls Church. He really seemed to get, you know, obviously he gets the housing affordability problem, but he really seemed to understand that in spite of the fact that we are an affluent jurisdiction, we still have a lot of people who have needs, and housing is chief among them. And his response to our request, and it was, you know, it was an ask, you know, and the mayor in very kind of, you know, polite and persistent terms, was, you know, responded to immediately and well by Senator Saslaw and his staff. And, you know, that initiative, after many years of talking and some doing, I mean, we've added some ADUs in the mixed-use buildings, but we all know that we haven't done enough to try to address the housing affordability issue. And if this budget item comes through in Richmond, we still have to wait for Thursday and the governor's signature and so forth. But that is a real expression of a lot of people's commitment to housing affordability, and, you know, hard work by elected officials, staff, and others, others in the room who have, you know, cultivated a good relationship with our representatives in Richmond. And I just want to thank everybody who's had a hand in that, because that's a very important story coming out of this year's budget. Thanks.
Vice Mayor Connolly.
Thank you. I want to say thanks to both of you for presenting budgets that really show our priorities and presenting them in ways that are easy for the public and all of us to understand exactly what the priorities of council and of the school board are for moving our city forward. So thank you very much. Mr. Shields, my question, dividend, is that the 0.16 million on slide number 9?
All right, 0.6.
It says 160,000 or 0.16 million.
Let me just, so you know that we haven't forgotten, on page 1 of the budget book,
Page one.
In the first chart in the city manager's message, the dividend, the pension, or a return on investment of $640,000 is shown in that chart. So I didn't have it in my slides, but it is in the first page of the budget, and we'll just make sure that that does remain part of. We don't lose sight of that.
We definitely don't want to lose sight of that,
yeah.
Because when I voted for that 6 years ago, that was my biggest fear, is that that $640,000 savings every year was just going to dissipate and disappear. And I think it's really important every year to make sure we commemorate and memorialize the fact that we invested $10 million, $11 million in the pension so that we would have that ongoing stream of money that we don't owe towards pensions. So thank you for having that in there.
And just to complete that thought, it's a penny and a half on the tax rate equivalent that is going to fund the George Mason High School. I mean, when pay for it. So the tax rate would be higher by a penny and a half if it weren't for that action.
Right. And it took me about 2 years to understand that. So I want to make sure that everyone else does as well. And then my other question is from Mr. Anderson, or maybe Dr. Noonan, just about the student, per student cost. And that is a fixed moment in time where we look at the pupil count as of September 30th. And I just, can you talk a little bit about how the pupil count changes and how it has even changed in the last month or so with the addition of new students? So it's a fraction, but the denominator changes depending upon how many students we have in the school division.
That's right. And for the purposes of making that chart, it is a snapshot in time, September 30th enrollment, as you said. But that was in order to be able to have a baseline that carried through. Throughout the year, we get on a monthly basis updates as enrollment is going and where students are coming into the system from, and that sort of thing is a level of detail that I would have to point to Dr. Noonan for. But in the last month, we have had a somewhat of an influx. So do you want to talk about that?
Sure. Yep, thanks for the question. One of the things that I have tried to brief the council and our board on is that I think to world events than any other, certainly in the Northern Virginia region. And as a consequence of that, because of some changes in placements of diplomats and State Department families and some evacuees, we have actually gained an enrollment in the last month and a half or so by about 34 students. And we anticipate we're going to see some more students coming in too as some of the other areas begin to close off and more families come home. So that is something that we don't anticipate we don't know is going to happen, but we do try to plan for, which is sort of back to Mr. Anderson's point earlier about why do we have contingency reserve just in case things like that do happen. So we expect that we are going to see some more students, but we welcome them and are really glad that they're with us.
Thank you.
Okay. Just before we keep going, I just want to remind everyone we have technically not started the business on the agenda yet, and we do have a closed session tonight. So with that, Mr. Lichtenhouse.
Thanks. To my city questions, why do we get a break for the East Falls Church and West Falls Church closings in terms of our prorated contribution to Metro?
No.
I didn't think so. Just where those hawk signals are going. We have four hawk signals going in the city. I'd just be curious to know where those are. I think one's up on Haycock. Are we doing one on near Oak and Broad as well?
Oak and Broad,
Barry,
Fairfax and Broad, Barry and Broad, and then through a different grant, there's actually one around mid block around where Mad Fox used to be.
Okay. On the technology front, the regional investment in the cybersecurity.
Yes.
Who does that include? What jurisdictions?
We're still working through the details of it, but it would be our adjacent smaller jurisdictions.
Okay. I had a conversation with Libby Garvey after a COG meeting. We were talking about cybersecurity as well as COVID-19, and she had recommended getting together with our immediate neighbors, Arlington and Alexandria, to talk about some regional cooperation. So I would just put that on your radar. She was very open. It was actually her idea. So I think that that could be useful. And then does that investment, is that just for the 1 year? Is this an investment we're going to make year after year?
It's envisioned as an ongoing expense.
Okay. And then I would like to have a conversation at some point about the impact of the potential increase in stormwater fees, not just to the residents, but the businesses as well, because it can be pretty significant for the buildings, which then gets passed on to the local businesses, and so can be a pretty big number. Got some experience dealing with that in Maryland, and I'd just like to chat with you guys about mitigating some of that risk there.
That's right.
So, thanks.
All right. So, given the hour, I'm going to keep my comments brief. I think it's a great start on both sides, school side, city side. We're doing lots of good things in this budget, so many things that we've been talking about over the years, and I think it's representative of the community's values and priorities. And so I think it's an excellent start. I've got some questions. I'm going to have some questions and some comments, but I think for tonight I'm just going to leave it at that. And thank you all for coming out, and let the public once again know that this is the start of a process. And we've got a lot more to go, a lot more opportunities for comments. We appreciate everyone coming out this evening. Look forward to working with you all.